So as I said earlier, so the basal bone differs from the alveolar bone in what? In function, that because the alveolar bone has to form in response to the tooth, okay. So the tooth will act as a periosteal matrix for the alveolar bone to form. So it is the function which differentiates the basal bone from the alveolar bone. See, the growth and development of the alveolar bone is directly related to the development of teeth. The absence of teeth, no alveolar bone, okay. Which of the following shows 200% of its adult growth by the age 9 to 10 years? Now you know your Scammon's growth curves or differential growth of your tissues, isn't it? Now which tissue shows more by around 200%? It is your lymphoid tissue, which infers your immunity, and it has to grow by 200% by around 9 to 10 years. Later it involutes or regresses back. Okay, 100%. Neural tissue will reach 100% by around 6 to 7 years, but 200%, the one tissue which grows is the double the amount is your lymphoid tissue, which confers immunity and later it involutes back. You see the Scammon's growth curve, where you see the lymphoid tissue reaching 200% by the age of 10 years approximately, okay, and then the neural tissue by 6 to 7 years. This is the general tissue, which is in a S-shaped format, and then the genital tissue at the puberty. So the human body does not grow at the same rate throughout the life, and different organs at different rates, at different amount, at different times, so called as differential growth. So different tissues at different rates, at a different pace, at different time. So this is the Scammon's growth curve. The neural tissue completes most of its growth by around 6 to 7 years, and the lymphoid tissue by around 13 to 14 years it doubles up. It is a mechanism to protect against infection, and it regresses back, and the only tissue to show negative growth or involution, okay. And the genital tissue grows after the age of puberty. Till the puberty there will be no growth till the adult. At birth, the following structure is nearest size will attain it adulthood, like at the birth the size is almost close to the adult. Which part? It definitely cannot be a mandible, it definitely cannot be the middle face, because they are away from the cranium. Now in cranium, whether it is voltar base, which is closer to the head, or which is close, is vault, is the most part which is cephalic in presentation. So cranial vault will attain size similar to that of adulthood at birth, then later cranial base, then maxilla, then mandible, okay. This is as depicted by your cephalocaudal gradient of growth, which states that there is an axis of increased growth gradient from the cephalic to the caudal region. That is, structures which are closer to the cephalic part grow at an earlier time when compared to the structures which are far away from the cephalic part. That is, structures which are caudally present or which are away from the cephalic part will grow at a later stage. So similarly, your cranial base, which is away from the cranial vault, will grow rapidly later, whereas your cranial vault will reach to the adult size even at birth, okay. So postnatally the face will grow more when compared to the skull. So postnatally the face, this is face, this is the cranium. So the viscerocranium would have grown more at birth or before birth. So postnatally it is the neurocranium which, okay, the face will grow later, that is the viscerocranium, whereas neurocranium would have already grown, okay. So at birth the head would have occupied around 30 to 40% of the body height and limbs less, whereas in an adult the head will occupy only 2.5%, okay. Postnatally the cephalocaudal growth gradient pattern is seen as mandible growing rapidly than maxilla. So postnatally what will grow more when compared to the maxilla? The mandible will grow later because it is away from the cephalic presentation. So maxilla growing rapidly, not possible, because the growth of maxilla is completed first when compared to the mandible. Rapid growth of midface, no, both growing equal, not at all. So the mandible will grow little later when compared to the maxilla. Most cranial sutures close by 5 years, that is all your fontanellas are closed and your cranial sutures by close by 5 years of age. Growth of your anterior cranial base, that is your cella, tarsica and nasion, that is the anterior cranial base and the posterior cranial base. The anterior cranial base growth is completed by around 8 to 10 years, most of the growth. It extends from the cella to the nasion and it acts as a stable reference plane, SN plane. The body tissue that grows rapidly but shows minimal growth after 6 to 7 years is 100% of the growth is achieved by 6 to 7 years. That is your neural tissue, that is brain. Okay. The negative growth is characteristic of thymus, which is a lymphoid tissue or involution. Negative growth is called involution and it is characteristic of lymphoid tissue, which is 200% of the adult size by the age in the late childhood by 12 years, and later by 18 years it undergoes involution and reaches the adult size. Mandible closely follows which growth curve? It follows the lymphoid curve? No. Neural? No. It follows the general growth curve, that is an S-shaped or S-shaped symbolic general tissue it follows. Maxilla and mandible closely follow the curve of somatic tissues, that is the general tissues, S-shaped curve. Okay. Growth of mandible in boys as compared to the girls will occur, in boys it will occur at a little later age, whereas in girls it will occur at an earlier age. The reason being the maturation, because of the peak height velocity or PHV, that is nothing but peak height velocity of maturation is earlier in females when compared to males because of the hormones. Okay. So the growth of mandible in boys is more sustained when compared to girls. Considering the growth of the face in all the three planes, growth ceases last in which direction? I have just told you earlier. Growth ceases last in the vertical direction, in face, not the cranium. In the face, the growth ceases first in the transverse plane, followed by sagittal and last in the vertical. Okay. Let us explain this. So the vertical growth or height is the last to cease in the face. So first is the width, that is the transverse, next length, that is the sagittal, and the last is the height, that is the vertical. Clear? In relation to face, whereas in cranium, see here, there is a difference. Whereas in cranium, it is the height, that is the vertical is first, the height, next comes width, transverse, last is depth. I repeat, cranium it is height, next width, next depth, that is vertical, transverse, sagittal, whereas face it is transverse, then sagittal, then vertical. Okay. So face it is again same, transverse, sagittal and then your vertical, width, depth and height. So the height shows the greatest incremental changes postnatally, that is the vertical changes are more in the face. So in the three planes of space, in both maxilla and mandible, growth is completed first in the width, that is the transverse plane. Growth is completed first in the width, that is the transverse plane. Which of the following is least effective in determining the site of bone deposition in experimental methods, that is your radiographs? They do not explain the site, isn't it? What exactly is happening? Implants, alizarin stains, tetracycline, they are all experimental methods, but this is a longitudinal method, radiographs. So you do not know what exactly is happening with relation to the bone, isn't it? So implant stains, they indicate the dynamic changes and they are experimental methods, whereas radiographs are only static changes, they are over longitudinal period. You take serial cephalograms and then superimpose and check. Jork, I have told earlier also in the first introduction class, Jork is credited with longitudinal studies of implants. Serial cephalograms, he has placed tantalum implants and predicted the growth changes. So, Jork used the implants for predicting facial growth changes. This approach is called as a longitudinal approach. Over a period of time, the same subject, he has taken suppose 10 subjects, the same subject he is reading at 6 years, 7 years, 8 years, 9 years, 10 years, 12 years. So, he same person is subjected to repeated cephalograms and he will superimpose and check. So, it is a longitudinal study. So, he has used tantalum implants in the maxilla and mandible and they are superimposed, and he also used various radioisotopes used were technetium 33, calcium 45 and potassium. These are radioisotope message, okay, these are all experimental methods measure. Who proposed the nasal septal theory? There are various theories of craniofacial growth, okay. In that, nasal septal theory is nothing but your cartilaginous theory. Nasal septal cartilage theory, and it was proposed by Latham. See, Melvin Moss has given your functional matrix theory, and Sisher has given your sutural theory. Van der Linden has given your multifactorial theory. Actually, this is Van der Limbach multifactorial theory, okay. And then Latham has given your nasal septal theory. This is Van der Limbach. So, Scott's hypothesis emphasized that the cartilage of the nasal septum will be the pacemaker for the growth of the maxilla. Nasal septal cartilage is the pacemaker for the growth of the maxilla according to the Scott's hypothesis. James Scott and Latham both are credited to the nasal septal cartilage theory, okay. Enloe's V principle is found in Enloe's. Enloe have given two theories, one is V principle and one is counterpart principle, okay. Now, V principle is found in what? Is found both in maxilla and mandible. How the maxilla goes, palate, and then the ramus and the condyle. So, both maxilla and mandibular growth is explained by the Enloe's V principle. Now, what happens in this V principle? Bone deposition occurs on the inner sides of the V and resorption on the outer sides of the V, and it expands, and the simultaneous deposition and takes place resulting in the two ends of the V widening. So, according to the counterpart principle by Enloe, which of the following is the counterpart of anterior cranial base? So, now imagine the skull. Now, where is the anterior cranial base? So, now what is the counterpart? Now, anterior cranial base is in relation to your nasomaxillary complex. What is the counterpart principle, which is the counterpart to your anterior cranial base? It is your nasomaxillary complex. Now, I will give you examples. Now, if you see, for the nasomaxillary complex, it is your anterior cranial base. Now, for your middle cranial fossa, it is your ramus, okay. Upper arch, lower arch, okay. For bony maxilla, corpus of the mandible, that is the basic body of the mandible, okay. Maxillary tuberosity, lingual tuberosity. So, these are counterparts. So, the growth of one is interdependent on the other growth. Now, your anterior cranial base has grown sufficiently, accordingly your nasomaxillary complex will reciprocate. You understand? If my maxilla is short, mandible also tends to be short, or it will compensate. You understood? Likewise. So, what this counterpart principle says is, the counterpart principle of craniofacial growth states that the growth of certain skeletal components are related specifically to their other structural or geometric counterparts. You understand? So functional matrix theory suggests that the determinant growth of skeletal tissues resides in the osseous tissues. Growth is dependent on functional matrices or non-osseous tissues. The growth of skeletal tissues depends on skeletal tissues? No, it resides in the non-osseous or functional matrices, isn't it? The growth or the skeletal growth or the bony growth or osseous growth is obligatory and secondary to the mechanisms which are functioning in the functional matrices or the non-osseous component. That is functional matrix. Your tooth is a functional matrix for your alveolar bone. Your medial pterygoid muscle, and your lateral pterygoid muscle, accordingly to your different components of your mandible, they are muscles, non-osseous tissues. So their attachment is responsible for the growth of your microskeletal units on the mandible. So Maas introduced the doctrine of functional matrix, whereas the functional cranial component was given by van der Klaas. He says, he attempts a relationship between form and function. The growth of the skeletal components depends largely on the functional matrices or non-skeletal tissues. Okay. Now, oral and nasal capsule of functional growth are related to. There are two types of matrices. One is periosteal matrix, the other is capsular matrix. Now, what is periosteal matrix? I will tell you. Now, capsular matrices are nothing but your oral and nasal capsule. Orofacial capsule and your nasal capsule is your capsular matrix. Now, functional matrix are of two types. That is, all your soft tissues and spaces, muscles, glands, nerves, vessels, fat, teeth, all are functional matrices. Okay. They are nothing but your periosteal matrix. Your tooth is a periosteal matrix for alveolar. Then there are two types. One is periosteal and the other is capsular matrix. Now, periosteal matrix is like your blood vessels, nerves, glands. They correspond to the immediate local environment. They act on the related microskeletal units. Now, your lateral pterygoid is there, medial pterygoid is there. They attack your ramus, angle, coronoid. That is, these are all the microskeletal units on the mandible. Mandible is a macroskeletal unit. In that, you have got various microskeletal units. So, in that microskeletal units, you have these periosteal matrices which act on them directly. And when they act directly, they produce a change in the transformation of the size. This is transformation, active change. Whereas this capsular matrix, which are neurocranial or orofacial or nasal capsule, they bring about, unlike periosteal matrix, they bring about indirect or passive change, which is secondary and results in translation. There is no active bone resorption or formation. It is only passive change. It is not an active change. It is translation. For example, now if you take an orbital capsule, if your orbital capsule is not there and your eye is not there, then there is no orbital capsule. You understood? Now, eye is a functional matrix, or eye is a soft tissue, non-osseous tissue for your orbit to develop. Now, what is orbit? Orbit is nothing but an osseous tissue. Orbital cavity is nothing but an osseous cavity, or it is a bony component. Now, that is subject to the development of your eye. You understood now? So, that is your capsular matrix or orofacial. Now, what this says, now entire, now neurocranial capsule, brain is there, if brain is not developed adequately, where your cranium will develop? There is no development of brain. When brain is not there, why your cranium has to develop? Why your cranial vault has to develop? Why your cranial base has to develop? Isn't it? So, brain, which is a soft tissue, acts as a functional matrix for the development of your cranium, which is a hard tissue. Clear? So, that is your neural capsule. So, this is a passive change. Next, functional matrix is revisited by Maas later into different things. Functional matrix was revisited later. He again told 4-5 theories. This is slightly over the head. So, just blindly remember, connected cellular network, this is called CCN, mechanotransduction, epigenetic epithesis, septal cartilage. We all know septal cartilage was given by Scott. He is nowhere related to Maas. So, identify. which is not related, so septal cartilage. Okay. So what is functional matrix component given by van der Klaas, later revised by Moss? Moss has hypothesized as 6 things: genetic, epigenetic causation, mechanical transduction, CCN connected cellular network, genomic and epigenome, next epigenetic antithesis, and genetic and epigenetic factors. This is just you have to mug up, and the basic in this question is you rule out the septal cartilage is not related, so remove it. Now, growth of oral structures is mainly influenced by both hereditary and environment, yes or no? Not just hereditary nor environment, it is a combination of both, isn't it? If you see the factors in etiology by Graeber, he has classified into two types molecules. One is hereditary, the other is environmental factor, general factors and local factors. So, hereditary and environment both are equally important. So, skeletal growth is determined by both. So, the condylar cartilage of mandible is told to be a primary, secondary, tertiary or non-growing. Condylar cartilage is not a primary cartilage, it is a secondary cartilage. Now, what is the difference between a primary and secondary cartilage? A primary cartilage is one like your epiphyseal plates, so which will grow by itself, but condylar cartilage is a secondary cartilage and it is influenced by the other inductive forces. Okay. The first evidence of the cartilage getting converted to bone in craniofacial skeleton occurs at what age? That is calcification, cartilage to bone. This normally occurs in 8th week intrauterine, that is prenatally by 8th week there is first evidence of calcification. See, 4th to 8th week of intrauterine life you see the cranial base formation. So, during this phase you see the first calcification, later from around the 40th day you see it is slowly converted, so onset of the cranial. Now, 40th day is nothing but your approximately you divide by 7, so 7 6 are 42, that is 7th week of intrauterine life. So, 7th or 8th week of intrauterine life you see the first calcification, and 4th week you see the basic formation, evidence of some formation, that is initiation. Age of closure of spinoccipital synchondrosis is 18 years, 18 to 20 years till then spinoccipital synchondrosis works. Okay. Spinoccipital synchondrosis closes at 18 to 20 or 25 years, and this is responsible for the active growth up to 12 to 15 years of your anterior cranial base. Okay. Premaxilla is derived from the frontonasal process. We know that the premaxilla is from the frontonasal process, philtrum and premaxilla is from the frontonasal. The primitive palate, that is premaxilla, harbors your incisors is formed from the frontonasal process. This is the frontonasal process, this is the philtrum, median nasal process, and then the lateral nasal process. The length of the maxilla increases by, how does the length increase? So, it is by the surface opposition with the tuberosity. See, growth at the midpalatine suture will increase the width, midpalatal suture growth will increase the width, that is in the transverse plane. Now, alveolar bone downward, that will give vertical, isn't it? So, what will cause the length? Surface opposition with the maxillary tuberosity. This is maxillary tuberosity in the upper, lingual tuberosity in the lower, endless counterpart. So, correspondingly. So, this has got two types of displacement, as I told, primary displacement and secondary displacement. Primary displacement is within itself the growth is occurring and the maxilla is moving downward and forward, and the tuberosity is going upward and back. And secondary displacement is where the growth of the cranial fossa, middle cranial fossa. The middle cranial fossa is growing, so the counterpart for the middle cranial fossa is your anterior cranial fossa and middle cranial fossa. Now, your anterior cranial fossa is growing, then the nasomaxillary complex has to grow, isn't it? So, once the anterior cranial fossa is growing, then the nasomaxillary complex has to grow downward and forward. The growth is not directly occurring in the maxilla, growth is occurring at the cranial fossa, but still mandible maxilla is displaced downward and forward. It is secondary displacement. See here, middle cranial fossa grows forwards and upwards, whereas a passive displacement occurs of the nasomaxillary complex in a downward direction, downward and forward. At birth, the palate is relatively flat in adults, but slowly it will become a vault shaped. The palate will become like a palatal vault, dome shape. Now, what is the reason for this to occur? How does this change occur? Is there any resorption in the palatal vault? Is there growth of the alveolar bone? Yes, when the teeth erupts, there will be growth of alveolar bone. Now, this is what which will cause the palate from becoming flat to vault shape. And there is surface apposition on the oral side, or that is of the palatal surface, and resorption on the nasal surface. So that will also help in deepening of the palate with the growth of the alveolar bone. So apposition inwards and resorption outwards, that is on the nasal aspect. Cleft lip occurs due to the non-union of your maxillary process and the frontonasal. Cleft lip, not palate, okay. That is your frontonasal and your maxillary process. And the number of ossification centers on the mandible are, they are basically 2 in number in the region of the mental foramen lateral to the Meckel's cartilage, okay. See, ossification center in mandible, basically they are 2 in number and they are in the mental foramen area lateral to the Meckel's cartilage. So 2 in number, 1 for each half, the 6th week which will be the future mental foramen and lateral to the Meckel's cartilage, where the inferior alveolar nerve bifurcates into the mental and incisive branch. They are your primary ossification centers. Site at which the ossification stops is your lingula. Lingula is the site where the ossification of the mandible stops. As the age advances, the human profile generally remains same, becomes more convex, or there is a decrease in the convexity or decrease in the concavity. What this means is, initially there is more convex, our profile is convex. Why? Because the mandible is not developed, the mandible is retrogradic, mandible maxilla is forward. With age, because of the cephalocaudal gradient of growth, the mandible will grow farther and later. So the profile which was convex earlier will reduce, the convexity will gradually reduce or decrease because of the relatively more growth of the mandible for a longer duration, okay. So the decrease in the convexity, clear? So due to the catch up growth of the mandible, the convex profile flattens or decreases or relatively becomes straight. The head of the condyle shows growth by, we know, the proliferation of the condylar cartilage. The arch space for the eruption of the permanent second and third molars. Now, how do you get space for the eruption of permanent second and third molars? It is because of the resorption of the anterior border of the ramus, not the posterior border. See, there is the ramus. This ramus is relocated, remodeled and relocated. What was my anterior, what was my posterior border will become anterior border later. At the age of 6, this is my posterior border. Now, this will become an anterior border at the age of 12. Because this anterior border has gone back, it is relocated. So my posterior border is becoming anterior border with age, okay. So there is resorption which is occurring in the anterior border, that is why we will create space. So this anterior border has come back. So what was my posterior border will become anterior border later. So how do you get space for your molars is by the resorption of your anterior border. In an individual whose mandible is growing less forward than expected, the lower incisors will probably be inclined. This is an interesting question. See, mandible is growing less when compared to the maxilla. So automatically what you will suspect, you will expect even the incisors also to be inclined back, that is inclined backward or retroclined. Mandible is growing less when compared to the maxilla. What will happen to the incisors? Incisors also should be placed backward, because mandible is back, incisors should be back, normal phenomena. but we have given something else forward. What does that mean? The incisors are proclined. Why? See, nature has given compensation mechanism. In a class 2 skeletal discrepancy, where the upper arch is more and the lower arch is short, the lower teeth will tend to match to the upper. So, invariably the lower teeth will procline and the upper teeth will try to slightly retrocline to meet. So, this is called as compensation. This is basically a dental compensation to the skeletal problem. What is the skeletal problem there in a skeletal class 2? The lower jaw is short or retrognathic. Now, how will the nature mask it? By proclining the lower incisor severely. Understood? That is why when we do an orthognathic surgical procedure, we extract lower first bicuspids and we pull the lower incisors back to the normal position, which will increase the overjet. That is called reverse orthodontics. When we are doing presurgical orthodontics for any advancement procedure, we extract lower first bicuspids. Why? To retract the proclined lower incisors into the normal inclination and increase the overjet. So, this is called reverse. So, nature, what? Nature is great. It will try to compensate the skeletal discrepancy, decrease the overjet by proclining the lower incisors. You understood? So, whenever the mandible is short or less than expected, lower incisors will be inclined forward, not backward. In a class 3, the upper incisors will be proclined and the lower incisors will retrocline. That is a class 3. Okay. Now, he has given here. See. So, this is called as dentoalveolar compensation, where the lower incisors are proclined. Clear? The mid symphysal suture fuses at the age of 18 months, 18 to 20 months. Normally, 18 to 20 months there is fusion. In suture, there is a proliferation of the connective tissue followed by replacement of bone. What is this called? This is referred to as apposition. Initially, there is connective tissue followed by your bone. Bone grows by apposition. So, it is nothing but your appositional growth. Joint between any your cranial walled bones is a suture. So, between the sutures, there is a cartilage band. This is referred to as your, see, these are the sutures and there is a cartilaginous band which is entrapped between the sutures. That is referred to as your synchondrosis. And if there is a fusion of your suture prematurely, it is called as synostosis. Okay. Combination of deposition and resorption which occurs in different bones of the skull will result in the growth movements towards the depository surface is termed as drift. Because there is resorption and cortical drift, there is resorption and deposition and the bone invariably moves towards the depository surface, positive, negative, towards the depository surface. It is called as cortical drift. Remodeling also, there is deposition and resorption, but in remodeling the result is relocation. The bone is relocated. That is also an example of drift. So, remodeling also is a form of bone deposition and resorption resulting in bone relocation. As I told earlier, the anterior part of the ramus is relocated posteriorly. What was the posterior border would become anterior border with age. So, that is remodeling of the ramus relocating the row, resulting in relocation of the ramus. So, drift is combination of deposition and resorption resulting in the growth movements towards the depository surface. So, this is what is relocation and remodeling. So, remodeling is nothing but a progressive sequential change in the position. Result of remodeling is called relocation. See, what is happening? See, this is my anterior border at age 6. This is at age 14, you assume 14 or 15. This is my posterior border. Okay. Now, what has happened to my posterior border at the age in an adult? It has become my anterior border. You see this vertical line, this is my posterior border at a young age. Now at an adult age, now this has become my anterior border. Is it clear? So this is remodeling causing relocation, change in the position, that is drift, movement of the bone. Sorry, which of the following statement is false? All growth centers are not growth sites. This is incorrect. All growth centers are growth sites, but all growth sites cannot be growth centers. A growth site is merely a place where growth occurs, whereas a growth center is a growth site where growth is genetically determined. So all growth sites are growth, sorry, all growth centers are growth sites, but vice versa is not true. All growth sites cannot be growth centers. So this is incorrect. So all growth sites are not growth centers. Yes. Growth, yeah, a growth center has got its innate growth potential which is predetermined genetically, like your epiphyseal growth cartilage or growth plates. Whereas growth site, anything, your condyle is a growth site, but it is not a growth center like that, because it has not, it is not a primary cartilage, it is not got growth by itself, it is subject to the response. So a growth center is controlled by genetics, yes, absolutely. So this is true. A growth site is a spot where growth occurs, yes. So which is false? This one. So growth sites are mere places where growth occurs, whereas growth centers are where the special growth sites which have the control over overall growth, like your epiphyseal plates. So not all growth sites are growth centers. All growth sites cannot be growth centers, but all growth centers are growth sites. Downward and forward growth of the face is a result of upward and backward growth of condyle and maxillary suture. As I told you earlier, the face, what we see, will grow down and forward, isn't it? So what you will think, all the structures behind are also growing down and forward only, you will think, but it is not the case. The condyle, as I said, will grow posteriorly. Posterior means back, superiorly and laterally, but mandible is growing down. Now why? This has to keep in pace with the cranial base, because this has to articulate with the glenoid fossa. You understand? So it has to reach, it has to pace with the glenoid fossa. So when it has to articulate with the cranial fossa or the cranial base, so it is growing posteriorly, superiorly and laterally, but mandible invariably, what you are seeing outside is downward and forward. So it is upward and backward growth of condyle and the sutures. So actual growth occurs in the posterior direction in the condyle, posterior direction of the ramus, tuberosity and the superior surface. But the virtual effect, what you see outside in reality, is the forward and the downward growth of the face. Clear? This is again your Enroe's counterpart principle. An early pubertal growth spurt indicates what? That the child is fastly maturing, isn't it? The peak height velocity of that particular child is earlier. Now growth spurts can be just before birth, 1 year after birth, or mixed dentition growth spurt, and it differs in boys and girls. In boys it is at relatively at a later time, okay. And prepubertal growth spurt, boys again it is at later time, 14 to 16 years, whereas in girls it is at 11 to 13 years. Now this period is very important for us, because if we have to use any myofunctional appliance or a growth modulation appliance where you need to do any skeletal jaw correction, it can be possible only by using this growth period during pubertal or prepubertal growth spurt. Now post-pubertally you can't correct any skeletal malocclusion by using your myofunctional or extraoral orthopedic appliances. Functional jaw orthopedics cannot be done post-pubertally. It has to be done pre-pubertal and pubertal. And post-pubertal is important to do your surgical correction. You can't do any surgical or orthognathic surgery before puberty. Post pubertally you have to do. Scammon's growth curve, which is false in Scammon's growth curve. Neural tissues, most of the growth complete by 6 years, yes. 6 to 7 years they reach adult size, so this is correct. Lymphoid tissue reaches 200, then later regresses, yes. Genital tissue, most of the growth is completed by the age of puberty, no. The growth starts and it reaches the adult size by the age of 20. This is the Scammon's growth curve. So lymphoid, in genital you hardly see any growth till 13 years, till puberty. Growth completion of basal cranium as compared to the jaws. Basal cranium, see, cranial vault first, next cranial base, next is your jaws. So this will precede, isn't it? First is your cranial vault, next is your cranial base, followed by jaws. So this will precede, isn't it? So the cranial base will precede the jaws. Greatest amount of cranial growth occurs by birth to 6 years. Cranial growth, not face. By 5 years most of it is accomplished. By the age of 5 to 6 almost 90% of the growth of the skull is completed. Okay. Maximum growth of the skull is completed by the age 5 to 6. Whereas growth of cranium can continue little later. The cranial vault increases rapidly postnatally. By the age of 6, what percent is completed is 90% is completed by the age of 6, the cranial vault. See, the at birth cranium is about 50 to 60% of adult size, and by 6 to 7 years it reaches 90% of the adult size. Direction of the growth of the basal cranium is upwards and forwards. The direction of how the cranial base grows is upwards and again forwards. The cranial base grows upwards and forwards, whereas the face grows downwards and forwards. This is because of your SOS, that is spinoxidal synchondrosis, which grows till the age of 18 to 20 years. Now, enlarged tonsils in a 6-year-old child by the age of 12 is most likely to be because of, it is because it is larger, or because of your lymphoid tissue which is 200%, isn't it? Lymphoid tissue increases by 200% and later it will involute. Cranial vault follows the growth curve of cranial vault. Vault follows neural tissue. As I told, functional matrix, brain corresponds to your cranium. Brain is nothing but neural tissue. Neural tissue is your cranial vault. And somatic or general tissue is your maxilla or mandible. Mandible more clearly follows. Okay. There is a more adolescent growth spurt in mandible than maxilla. Mandible follows growth curve of somatic tissue closely than maxilla. Both are correct, both are wrong. One is correct, one is wrong. See, more adolescent growth spurt in mandible than maxilla, yes, cephalocaudal gradient. Mandible has got, it grows later and further. And which will follow closely somatic tissue, just now I told, mandible, not maxilla. So both the statements are correct. One of the basic differences, sex differences in facial growth during puberty, what sexual dimorphism will exhibit is, there is a greater vertical development in males. Vertical development will occur more in males than in females. Growth of face is completed in the following sequence, which I have already told you. Face, this is not cranium, width that is transverse, depth sagittal, height vertical, WDH, width, depth, height, or transverse, sagittal, vertical. See here, cranium it is height, vertical first, transverse and sagittal, whereas face, width, depth, height. Which of the following dimension of face at birth is close to adult size? Adult size close is width, that is your transverse dimension which sees us earlier. Width of the face is close to the adult size at birth. height is completed last. Alizarin red complexes with what? Calcium in the bone. That is, the staining is courtesy the calcium. Alizarin reacts strongly with the calcium during the vital staining. Vital staining was by John Hunter or Belshire, and these two did vital staining as an experimental method of studying growth. And various other dyes are alizarin red, acid alizarin blue, tripon blue, tetracycline. And Belshire used these, Belshire also is credited with vital staining, Hunter and Belshire. Clockwise rotation refers to what? Clockwise mandibular rotation. So, mandible is rotating downward and posterior, down and back, clockwise, down and back. So, it will lead to a class 2 long face, down and back. If it is an anti-clockwise, up and forward. It is not upward and anterior, it is downward and posterior. So, a clockwise jaw rotation leads to posterior rotation, leads to an increased vertical face height, downward and backward, and a vertical grower class 2 with open bite. Whereas, anti-clockwise, decreased facial height, anti-clock. So, reduced facial height, reduced lower anterior facial height, short face. Okay. Seizures theory, seizure sutural theory, what he says? He says suture acts as an independent growth potential. That is what suture says. Suture social theory says growth in sutures is responsible for craniofacial growth, and it is got independent growth. And von Limburg's multifactorial theory, Moss functional matrix, Petrovic's servo system theory. These names you have to remember, who has given what theories. Scott's cartilaginous theory and also Latham. Scott and Latham. Servo system theory was given by Petrovic, just now I told you. Scott, Limburg, Van der Klaus, functional cranial component. Okay. Servo system was given by Alexander G. Petrovic. It is based on a cybernetic theory. It is a cybernetic knowledge based on the language. It's got various commands like you use in your software computers. Open system, closed system, loop, the cybernetic model with the feedback. Okay. So, given by Petrovic, Alexander G. Petrovic, the servo system theory based on cybernetics. This is the same thing again. Genetic theory by Brody, neurotrophism by Behrens, sutural by Seisher, cartilaginous Scott, servo system, cybernetics by Petrovic and Charlie. V principle given by Enloe is best demonstrated in the ramus of the mandible. V principle. Condyle also is there, but ramus is ideal. Okay. It expands, the ramus expands. According to V principle, the skeleton unit grows by deposition on the lingual, resorption on the labial. The best examples are the ramus of the mandible. The functional cranial component, or this concept, was given not by Melvin Moss, functional matrix theory by Melvin Moss, whereas functional cranial component was by Van der Klaus. Okay. Melvin Moss is credited to functional matrix, where Van der Klaus has given functional cranial, where Van Limburg multifactor. All of the following are considered microskeletal units except, see, chin microskeletal unit. Glenoid fossa, it is not part of mandible only. Yes or no? The answer is here only. Coronoid process, angle. Coronoid, everything are various components. Now, various microskeletal units in a macro. This is a macroskeletal unit. Mandible is a macroskeletal unit. And what are your microskeletal units? This is your condylar portion. This is your coronoid portion. This is your angular portion. This is your basal portion or your body main, and this is your alveolar portion, and this is your chin. So, these are all the microskeletal units. Now, for this here, what is attached to the ramus or the angle? Masseter. So, that is your periosteal matrix, which is directly acting on the which is directly acting at the angle of the mandible, microskeletal unit, angular component. What is attached to the condylar process? Lateral derivative. To the coronoid process? Temporalis. So these are all your periosteal matrices, all your muscles which are non-osseous tissues acting on the microskeletal units which are osseous tissues. So the growth of these skeletal components or osseous tissues is obligatory and secondary to the functional matrices or your periosteal matrices which are non-osseous tissues. Now then, for your alveolar bone, teeth, clear, and for chin, mentalis, clear. Oral and nasal capsule are related to your capsular matrix, they are not your periosteal matrix. Periosteal matrices are muscles, glands, blood, all those things. So capsular matrix are your oral capsule, orofacial capsule, nasal capsule, orbital capsule. So periosteal matrices are your blood vessels, nerves, glands, etc. Capsular matrix are neurocranial or orofacial. According to Moss, growth of periosteal matrices brings about transformation. Periosteal matrices will give active growth change, that is transformation of your microskeleton. This is what I was explaining. Whereas your capsular matrix will give translatory changes, which is passive. See, periosteal matrix gives active transformation, whereas your capsular matrix will give passive translation. Epigenetic factors controlling growth of skeleton are, they are basically outside the skeleton. Epigenetic, they are not within, they are outside the skeleton. Genetic factors present outside the skeleton. Okay. Intrinsic genetic, local epigenetic, general epigenetic, local environment, general environment. This is given by Van Limbaugh's multifactorial theory. Now, intrinsic genetic is within the genetic constitution or the genotype of the individual. Next, local epigenetic is, like as I said earlier, now if brain is not there, where will your cranium develop? If eyes are not there, where will your orbit develop? So it is local epigenetic. So it is the genetic information which is controlled in the adjacent structures which will help in the formation of the skeletal component. Next, general epigenetic. Now what do you mean by general epigenetic? Your growth hormone, pituitary hormone, if that is not there, how will the growth be regulated? Then local sex hormones. Hormones are again for your pubertal growth spurts. That is not there, any imbalance is there, where will the growth occur? So they are general epigenetic, they are outside the skeleton. Epigenetic means other than the skeleton. So local epigenetic, general epigenetic, intrinsic genetic. Next comes local environment. Now local environment is like habits, muscle force. General environment, nutrition, lack of nutrition, oxygen. Clear? These are five things in Van Limbaugh's multifactorial theory. Now all of the following are primary cartilages, except we know coronoid and condyle, they are secondary cartilages. Which of the following are sites of cartilaginous growth postnatally? Postnatally cartilaginous, one is a cartilaginous growth definitely, two, this is also cartilaginous growth only, isn't it? Then one, two, frontomaxillary suture, no, not. Then what it is, nasal septum also cartilaginous. So one, two and four. Alveolar process definitely not a cartilage. So postnatally is SOS, that is phenoxyhepatic synchondrosis, condyle and your nasal septal cartilage. Growth activity at which of these synchondrosis completes first? First, last is spinoccipital, 18 to 25. So first is intersphenoid, if I am not wrong, within 2 years. Intersphenoid ossify at birth itself, intersphenoid at birth. Spinoccipital 20 years, principal growth cartilage. Spinoethmoid 5 to 20. Interoccipital 3 to 5. There are 4 synchondrosis. Intersphenoids first seizes the growth at birth itself. SOS, spinoccipital synchondrosis, principal growth cartilage, till 5 to 25 years, ethmoid 5 to 25 and intraoccipital 3 to 5. Number of primary ossification centers in maxilla is 3, mandible it was 2. This is 2 for premaxilla, 1 for maxillary proper. 3, 2 for premaxilla and 1 for maxilla proper. Maxilla develops by intramembranous, mandible both intra and endochondral, especially the cartilage. In endochondral it is ethmoid, hyoid, incus, whereas intramembranous maxilla, nasal, zygoma, zygomatic, lacrimal, vomer all. Growth of maxilla in the vertical direction is due to the vertical direction, how that the growth occurs, it is basically the growth of the alveolus, that is as the teeth develops the alveolar component. The philtrum of the upper lip is formed largely by the philtrum is because of the which process? The globular process. Globular process, other name for your median nasal process, formed from the frontonasal process. The philtrum is formed from the median nasal process, and the lateral nasal process gives rise to your sides of the nose, that is the ala of the nose, and the two medial nasal process will give rise to the nasal septum. Cleft palate occurs during the disturbances in which weeks of intrauterine life? Cleft palate, it is not the cleft lip. Now cleft palate is around 8 to 10 weeks of intrauterine life, that is in the first trimester, in the third month of intrauterine life, okay. So cleft lip is 6 to 8 weeks in the second month, whereas cleft palate is the third month, between 8 to 10 weeks, okay. Meckel's cartilage gives origin to greater part of mandible. Meckel's cartilage? No. Contributes to the condyle? No. Greater part of it disappears without contributing to the mandible. 5 minutes ago. So greater part disappears without contributing to the formation of mandible. So basically Meckel's cartilage will disappear without contributing to the formation, and it will disappear. So it just acts as a template for the mandible to be formed. Ultimately Meckel's cartilage will not form anything, it just acts as a scaffold for the intramembranous bone formation, and it disappears. If you see, persistent part of it forms as an envelope and most of it disappears, and that disappears without contributing anything and gives rise to only malleus and incus. In a newborn child we generally see the mandible to be retrusion, isn't it? Newborn child the mandible is retrusive or retrognathic, that is why the profile is convex. Slowly it will, the convexity decreases as the child develops to adult. Main growth site in mandible is, the main growth site is condylar cartilage, growth site not center. After the age of 6 the greatest increase in size of mandible occurs distal to the first molar after 6 years, because the molars have to erupt, so there will be resorption. So distal to the first molar the resorption occurs, so greater changes, clear? A foreign body in the anterior border of the ramus of the mandible at 9 years compared to 6 years. Think you have placed an implant, small implant you have placed in the anterior border of the ramus at 6 years of age. What will it happen at 9 years? There is no anterior border only, isn't it? The posterior border is becoming anterior border. So what will happen? It will become free in the soft tissue. It will be in the air, isn't it? In the soft tissue, clear? Which of the following is a chondroid bone? Which is a chondroid bone? See, definitely not your maxillary or basal bone, can never be frontal bone. So what is the crest of your alveolar bone is your chondroid bone. The crest of the alveolar rim is your chondroid bone, okay.